syndrome and essential people. I was asked to introduce Sidney. The idea was to have the talk here in this department, which is essentially Sidney's old original department. He was, telling me, the first full-time member of staff, so effectively the founder of the department. He came here in 1943, which is strange, and stayed on as head of the department until 62, and then somebody who a number of people know, John Clifton, took over from 1962 until 1992. Yes. Then Dave Delphi took over from 1992 until 1999. He said his apologies and he couldn't come this evening. He was very sad not to be able to come. Then became vice provost, and I took over from 1999 until now. So it's a great pleasure that we have Sidney Osborn, who's a founding member of the department, to give a talk about the history of HBO. Thank you.
Thank you. Well, I wanted to give a talk about the history of the HBO, quite rather much, as medical physics. I've seen through the eyes of somebody who's been through it. And I'm going to talk about the last 6 years, simply because 6 years ago the HBA was formed. But I shan't say a lot about the last 30 years of that. You know much more about that than I do. I retired in 1978 at the age of 60, simply getting your side rules out. That makes me 85 at the moment. You know much more about the later part than I do, but the early part I'll be talking about mostly. I've always been interested in history, and now, somewhat to my surprise, I found myself part of it. So, first about myself. I took my London BSc in June 1941, having already decided on a career in medical physics. Soon after, I went to see Professor Maynard at what was then the Royal Cancer Hospital, bracket 3. In those days, of course, the hospitals, almost all of them, had to find their own finance, raise their own money. There was no NHS. And the more eloquent title you had for your hospital, the more likely you were to raise funds. So it was the Royal Cancer Hospital, bracket 3. Many of them have nothing to offer me, but commented in those days, the hospital physicist was worth his weight in radium. He referred me to Professor Russ at the Middlesex, who was running a scheme to enable a physicist to be available to any hospital in London requiring a physicist, but without one because of the war. The physicist then imposed to one Frank Farmer, latterly professor in Newcastle. But as from the December, he would become a lecturer in the medical school. So I was appointed to understudy him and take over from him. In those days, the work of a hospital physicist was almost entirely concerned with the treatment of cancer, involving the calibration of X-ray therapy machines and also the use of radium, which, however, was restricted in London because of the danger of bombing. Generally, radium was then stored in a borehole like that at Middlesex, but we could store small quantities locally in a specially made type of steel container. This is about a foot in diameter and about 2 feet in height. It had a hole 2 inches in diameter right down to the middle, and a brass container something like 10 centimetres long would slip into the bottom, and the screw's head with many, many turns would seal it in. They tried one of these at Woolwich Arsenal when they were designing it, put it next to a bomb and exploded it, and it just bounced beautifully. So they thought it would probably be all right to house radium. It was permissible to use radium clinically in those days only if the patient could be nursed in a relatively secure area, which at that time here was the basement of the private patient's wing. Actually, a bomb exploded in one direction of one of London's hospitals, and the whole building immediately collapsed on top of it. A long search found one of the two radium containers, one of two steel containers, in the rubble. Weeks later, it was found that the bomb must have exploded close to the second container, blowing it across the courtyard and into the opposite wing, which then collapsed on top of it. However, all the radium tubes were undamaged and ready for clinical use. Radium had been widely used before the war, mainly for interstitial and intracavitary treatments. to reduce the hazards from bombing, some 4 grams of radium, I think in modern terms that's somewhere about 150 gigabecquerels, as radium bromide and HBr solution was lodged in a tunnel off an old lime kiln in Chiltern Downs near Luton. This was in a plant from which the first product, of radium, the gas radon, could be extracted daily and sent to hospitals all over the country. The gamma radiation emitted was of course exactly the same as if radium were used, but the half-life was about 4 days instead of some 1600 years. Until December, I spent some time each week at the radon centre and the rest of the Middlesex under studying Frank Farmer. Now, Professor Russ had been one of the founder members of the British X-ray and Radon Protection Committee in 1921. He became a professor in 1919, by the way. The recommendations of this committee were the first in the world on the subject of radiation protection. But even by 1941, radiation protection was still a minor concern compared with today. There was certainly no legislation or codes of practice, and few recommendations. In diagnostic radiology, it was accepted that any patient would only get x-rayed very occasionally, and then only receive an infinitesimal dose of radiation. Any effect was therefore worn off before the next examination. I was asked to measure the radiation received by some such patients, and quickly found surprisingly high doses received by some. Thallium needle patients, for example, often received doses to the back in tens of rad, and the highest I measured was about 300 rad. This was largely due to fluoroscopy, as ND carried out without any intensification of the image, and also not being carried out particularly quickly. I also found that one particular projection of a patient in late pregnancy could result in the dose to the gonads of the fetus reaching tens of rad. I was at that time one of 3 people in Britain who were making such measurements, and this began to cause concern over the amounts of radiation that could be received by diagnostic x-ray patients. During my time at the Middlesex, when I was working with Frank Farmer, he was beginning his work on electronic instruments for measuring ionizing radiation. His first contained an electrometer valve with a very long stem, this sort of length, of high insulation glass with a good connection at the end. This is, of course, long before the days of transistors. Up to this time, the conventional method of measuring the strength of radioactive source involved in using this instrument, which you may or may not have seen, called the electroscope. You have to be fairly expert at making sure that these were properly prepared and so on. I must say, I found it much more convenient not to have too much of a gold bead hinge, and then a glass fiber covered in graphite was much better. You can see that in the telescope, much better for measuring where things were. I don't suppose these are used much nowadays, are they? Do they still figure in the degree syllabus, or is it now A-levels? Well, anyway, those are the things that we used in those days. And the sort of known effect was placed on the golden electroscope, between the distance from the electroscope, and then the gold leaf views and so on, and the ratio of, from 2 tubes would give you the ratio of the contents and so on. Other things being equal, which they weren't always. I've no idea how much radiation we received in doing this sort of thing, but it must have been quite substantial. The time taken was appreciable, shielding minimum. During this time, the idea was mooted that it might be possible to build an electronic metal detector to assist the surgeon in the removal of metallic foreign bodies. This was long before the days of transistors and commercial metal locators, and also in the early days with superhead radio receivers. Everyone then knew that movement near the coils of a tuned circuit of a radio receiver could alter the frequency of that circuit, caused the old familiar howls. Well, they were familiar to us, and they were not to be to you. Together with Frank, I played about with this for a bit and decided that it was not likely to be very useful. We published a brief note about it in The Lancet. In 1942, I saw an article in the Reader's Digest by an American surgeon which said how useful such a machine had been in their hospitals after the Pearl Harbor attack. I wrote him asking about his instrument. His reply convinced me he had no intention whatever of letting me know how it worked. A couple of years or so later, I had a further letter offering one free if we wanted it. He would get a sense of next time an American Pimbonnel was coming across his statue with supplies for war-torn Britain. He duly arrived, but at that time, Frank had moved to Newcastle and I had moved to UCH, so he reckoned that we owned the machine jointly. We were lodged with one of us, and if further needed, it was sent on the next mainline LNER express to be collected from the guard personnel. It was good at detecting iron and steel, very poor for non-magnetic metals, and useless for anything else like a glass. I'd already seen operations in metallic foreign bodies last for hours, with the metal not found at the end. With this machine, such operations were very much faster, almost always satisfactory. Indeed, the fastest such operation I witnessed took 17 and a half seconds by the theatre clock, from spin incision to removal. The American machine, and we've got a slide of that. Summon metal decay. It had a ferrite core as part of the circuit in here, which came right to the end here, and a rubber sheath. This rubber sheath actually could cover the whole thing, make it sterile for operation purposes. It was a locator, not really a detector. I've been interested to see recently that commercial metal locators now being used to used instead of X-rays to determine the presence of metallic foreign bodies. But this was a locator, not just a detector. There was one here at UCH when I left in 1962. I don't know what's happened to it since, but good. Thank you. You can have it afterwards, John. In 1941, in London, the Blitz was coming to an end, but still with air raids almost every night, and often by day as well. The big London teaching hospitals were evacuated to places in the home counties where a safety home or an underused mental hospital had grounds sufficiently large for the required walls and laboratories to be installed as prefabricated structures. I visited one during my time at the Middle East to calibrate the output of a superficial X-ray therapy machine being used by a dermatologist for treating skin cancers. These things get complicated. Here we are. In the early days of radiotherapy, there have been three units of radiation dose used, some of which you may have come across. The threshold erythema dose was one of the very early ones, and the pastille dose was also used in very early days. Very unsatisfactory because the radium platinum cyanide, of course, had a very pronounced quality dependence. And here's the Runker dose, the R dose, 1928 definition. Much more satisfactory. Now, the dermatologist asked me if I'd bought my pastilles. I said no, but I'd bought a victory in army, to which measured doses in Rankin units. He said he didn't mind, so long as I told the radiographer about how many pastille doses there were to one R unit. I replied that for the radiation we were using, about 300 R units to one pastille dose. The radium gamma rays, I think, would be more like 10,000. When I finished, I was packing up when the radiographer asked for help. Before leaving, the dermatologist had told her to select a medical student and treat a 1 centimeter diameter area of the upper arm with the dose of what I said was 1/4 pastille dose. He'd be in the next day and see from the skin reddening whether I'd done my calibration properly. A visit to another such hospital was to search for 2 small radium needles. Inserting radium into tissues, it would be packed tightly into a platinum tube about 2 millimeters in diameter and up to 10 centimeters long, sealed with gold solder. The superficial or intracavitary application would be packed into similar tubes, much shorter and some 5 millimeters in diameter. This patient had a cancer of the lip, and 3 small needles had been inserted some days previously. He was of low intelligence, found the needles irritating, and pulled 2 of the 3 out. When this was discovered, the staff searched the ward without success, and then called for help. I got there to see a sight I shall never, ever see again. The medical superintendent, the hospital administrator, and the hospital matron were all together searching the patient's bed, trying yet again to find the missing needles. We had no Geiger counters in those days, and the search instrument was known as the clucking hen. This instrument told me that there was radiation present, which turned out to be from the third needle still in the patient, sitting quietly beside his bed. He moved away, no further radiation detected. I asked where the floor sweepings would go, into the incinerator. This town turned out to be a gently smoking corrugated iron structure, half buried in the ground at the furthest corner of the estate. I confirmed that gamma radiation was coming from this and asked for the content to be ripped out. Old Bill had been a gardener on the estate before the war, so he came to help. After wisely filling his pipe with something that gave off a very, very strong smell. After about half an hour, I stopped him while I examined one bundle of material raked out and found one of the two missing needles. When he said he had cleared everything out, there was still radiation from an area in the middle of the incinerator. The last needle was found buried in the earth floor under an upturned half saucer. Fortunately, the incinerator was slow burning and low temperature. Both needles were still intact and ready for further use. In the last few days, I had letters from three people from the early days who regretted they were unable to be here. One of them was Pio Tully from Hull. He told me that for this purpose he used an ionization chamber. But of course, the sensitivity of detection was very poor in those days, so we had to have a very large ionization chamber, and they used a standard metal dustbin. One hot day in the middle of August 1942, on a Friday afternoon, it was about 4 p.m, a professor was on holiday in the Lake District, and I, with all of 9 months' experience behind me, was the senior member of staff actually in the department. One of the others, Clifford Walker, later of Exeter, was carrying out a research project for the professor on people who used luminous paint containing radium for luminizing dials of clocks. He would all meet at a large Victorian house in Hampstead, which he used to luminize him, taking test samples from all the folk working there. The results were quite crazy. He contained far more radioactivity than he expected. It turned out that on the Monday, the director of the outfit had taken delivery of some 50 milligrams of radium, a very large amount, as bromide in HBr solution in a glass tube in a lead pot. He put it on his personal research desk. He was then called to the phone, and then took a client out for lunch, and so on. It was after 5 when he turned round and said, "Where was I when all that happened?" "Ah, radium." But it was not on his bench. A search revealed the lead pot empty. Now this was the middle of a heat wave. In due course, he found out that the lab boy had had a fit of unaccustomed tidiness. He'd taken the tube out of the lead pot, smelt it, looked at it, must be water. Then he opened the window and poured it on the wilting flowers in the garden. That was Monday. On Wednesday, there was a thunderstorm. This was Friday afternoon. I went with Clifford to the premises and was very worried about the ground where the radium had been poured, since in wartime, any vacant land had to be used for growing vegetables. So we dug out as much of the soil as we could from there, loaded it into a garage nearby, stopped finishing it at almost midnight, the periodic shout to put that light out. We wired the professor, who said we should call in the MTL. In those days were the forerunners of the NRPB. They came, got all the soil that we'd so carefully dug out, put into the lower Thames. A few days later, I went to see if all was now well, to be approached by one of the staff who took me to a magnificent drawing room. She said that this was the room which she did her luminizing. There was the desk, and she kept the luminous paint in the on the shelf behind the desk. So this was the room they also used in the evenings, a sort of common room for the folk who lived on the premises. Was that all right? I said no. One day, I was looking through some old papers, and I came across a story dating from 1925. a normal 50 milligram radium tube was found to contain much less than that. It was sent for remaking, but it was found that only about half the normal content was still there. This tube was one of those which had been filled after the First World War with radium reclaimed from luminous dials from armaments. It was used to fill, well, this radium reclaim was used to fill radium tubes needed for hospitals. And it was all done using the soluble radium bromide to facilitate handling. However, the seal on this particular tube was inadequate, and there was fluid inside. It appeared that the body fluids of innumerable patients had seeped in and dissolved out some of the radium. It was impossible to trace those patients, but all the radium in all the country's hospitals was promptly recalled and repacked as insoluble radium sulfate to stop that thing ever happening again. In 1943, Professor Rusk called a meeting of the physicists in a hospital that he knew about to discuss setting up an association of hospital physicists, the HPA. There were only about 60 of us in the country at the time. Initially, it was an informal society of people interested in the subject. His concern for professional matters, sorry about this, his concern for professional matters didn't start seriously until the NHS was being set up in 1945 and 1948. In those days, few of the measuring instruments needed could be purchased. Many had to be made in-house. When I moved to UCH in 1943, I was the physics department for my first 3 years, with a Victorian arm meter, a lathe, a soldering iron, and a typewriter. Every time radium was used in the operating theatre, I was required to be there, with my charts, my tables, and my slide rule. After the size and position of the growth had been determined, I was given about 5 minutes to calculate the number and strength of needles required, their distribution, and the length of treatment time required to give the prescribed dose as uniformly as possible to the target volume. In viewing the X-ray films afterwards, I usually found there had been 3 ideas about the distribution of the needles. One was mine, after calculations were finished, the second was that of the surgeon, after he inserted them, and the third was what the X-rays showed. There was sometimes little similarity between the three. About 1944, I was asked to measure the radiation received by the staff in the X-ray department. There were no personal monitors available at all in those days, so I had to adopt a dental film, but partially covering it with lead. And I took the first week's results to the rep. He looked down and called for Dr. X. Ah, Dr. X, I have the results of last week's radiation measurements. You've only got so much. You're stacking, man. Unfortunately, his films offered an easy target to jokers. See if we get this right. Yes, unfortunately, these films I did could never be. This is one that was issued to the month of December to a senior registrar who went to his consultant upon another hospital on the 1st of January and therefore couldn't be traced afterwards. While I was at UCH in those days, I was required to join the firebomb squad. Our job was to move any incendiary articles from the roof down to the road or wherever else. And I misread my page. There we are. Get them off the roof and down to the street or anywhere before any fire could take hold. This meant being on duty every 6 nights. The hospital then existed, I think it does now, on 5 sites with roads between them. There were 15 of us on duty at any one time, 3 per site. Oh, we could choose where we slept. We could sleep, if we wished, on the balcony of the entry ward on the 4th floor, underneath the glass roof. Or if we didn't like that, we'd sleep in the sub-basement, underneath the hospital's main water intake. Fortunately, the bombs were never dropped on the hospital while I was on duty. Sorry, wouldn't you like to have a drink of... any drink, please. Immediately after the war, there was a general election at which everyone surprised. Winston Churchill was defeated. when Clement Attlee took over as Prime Minister. And one of his election promises was a national health service. He chose as his Minister of Health an Earl in Devon, a very strong-willed character. This led to a lot of apprehension. In the following 3 years of intense lobbying and negotiating, arrangements were reached that seemed to promise well for the future, especially for the medical profession, but even more especially for hospital specialists. Up to then, as a general rule, in the voluntary hospitals at any rate, though not run by local authority or other public body, consultants were honorary and unpaid for their hospital duties. But they were allowed to earn their living by treating private patients in the private patient's wing and charging fees. In the following years, that restriction scales were drawn up and agreed separately for many groups of health service workers, and the weekly machinery set up. Each hospital or group of hospitals used their fixed salaries quite arbitrarily. I started in 1941 at £200 a year. By the end of the war, I progressed to £550. Riches indeed. And we were able to get married and buy our first house for £1,150. I learned from a finance officer at one of London's richer hospitals that they spent a third of all their income on advertising for further donations. So the finance departments of the hospital were very much a money-raising concern. UCH still had a pre-war unit for external gamma ray therapy, containing about 6 grams of radium, called locally a radium bomb. The treatment head was built with sufficient shielding of natural uranium for the patient under treatment, as at all other times the radium was kept in the safe, linked to the head by flexible tubing. The bombing containing the radium was moved pneumatically, courtesy of Messrs. Hoover, from safe to head for treatment, and then back similarly after treatment. The tubing was disconnected from the safe every night and the safe locked. One Monday morning, the tubing was wrongly connected, the ring on the end of the flexible tubing being left cross-threaded on the fitting in the safe. As soon as the fan started, the air pressure built up, blowing the tubing off the safe and allowing the bobbin to describe a graceful parabola to finish under the sink in the corner of the room. After planning what we were going to do rather carefully, we put it back in the safe and the tubing connected properly this time. It was probably in the late 50s when I had a phone call from a somewhat bewildered civil servant. Soon after setting up of the NHS in 1948, the Ministry of Health took ownership of all radium in hospitals and sold it to the Ministry of Supply, who then charged hospitals for the rent of whatever radium they had. It was not too onerous for small radium needles, but an enormous charge for the 6 gram of our so-called radium bomb. I found out that we could replace this radium by cobalt-60, and replace it again every 3 years for a substantially smaller sum. So we got the required cobalt-60 and told the Ministry of Supply we no longer needed their radium. This was not well received in private. Probably in the late 1950s, when I had a phone call from a somewhat bewildered civil servant, we were given the task of compiling a suitable answer to a parliamentary question asked by an MP. Essentially, the question asked how it was that, if the new dirty thermonuclear cobalt bomb was so destructive, had been used in some UK hospitals for the treatment of cancer. I point out that cobalt bomb was a familiar name given to radiotherapy treatments said incorporating cobalt 60, had nothing whatever to do with thermonuclear device incorporating a casing of cobalt. I should have been chuffed to have seen that MP's face when my answer was read. At the end of the war, we heard about the atomic bombs used on Japan and took steps to find out what we could about them. Not long after, we heard that the wartime airfield at Harvard was being used for experimental work on nuclear energy under Sir John Cockcroft. He soon announced that work was underway to get GLEEP going, Graphite Low Energy Experimental Pile. First, among other things, small quantities of radioisotopes for research projects and medical purposes would be available. Director Dunn and his staff would give every help to any requests for radioisotopes for medical or medical research work. I went to see GLEEP and discussed ideas with the staff. The reactor was in the middle of what had been an aircraft hangar, encased in an immense wall and roof of concrete. There was a ladder. We climbed up and walked around on the top, found several people conducting experiments, some pieces of string with them, so they lowered things down into the corner and pulled them up again. In the late 1940s, the government decided the top brass of the three services needed to know something about the scientific background of the atomic bomb if it was going to be made in this country. I was told, I wasn't there, but I was told that Harvard ran a one-week course